it began here and began moving in this direction. You know, everything here was lost and still in an active state of burning. And then the wind shifted, the fire started traveling this way, and simultaneously the fire trucks, because of the weather, were no longer able to get up the hill. And so there was no way, there was no additional water available.
It was freezing cold outside, and we saw some students come running from the girls' dorm past the window. And we were going, what? What's going on, you know? And so we went outside, and we looked over to the main building, and the whole thing was blazing in the buildings that connected the main building, where the big room is today, all the way across the farm buildings to where Mrs. Emmett's house was, and the chapel, and the faculty living room, all of which is in a long chain of buildings, whereas now they have walkways with open roof and there's no building.
Watching this situation unfold, and there wasn't a lot that we could do, and the firefighting was limited. And it became more limited, as Leslie mentioned, when one of the trucks got stuck and it just, there was no more access. There's no way to get more water up here. And then at that point, the wind also shifted, and so the fire started traveling back this way and was clearly going to consume the main building, the big room, the girls' dormitory. You know, and we just were watching this, and this is what was going to happen. And at that point, the TD-18, which was one of the classic pieces of equipment that we had here, this bulldozer, was out in a field, and it came out later that for a couple of weeks, people had gone out to try to start it, to sort of bring it in and put it undercover for the winter, but it hadn't been able to be started. And Bob Pittman, in some miraculous moment, went out, got on it, and it started.
And then we saw the backhoe bulldozer machine with a lone figure silhouetted against the flames drive through the flames and separate in repeated drive-throughs the burning part of the connected buildings from the firewall and the big room. We're going, what's he doing? Do you remember that moment?
I do. Yeah. I do.
And then, as Leslie described, he came up and he's driving it through the flames back and forth, and the fire department are hosing water as close as they can, but not wanting to stall out the bulldozer or knock him off. So it was a very, precarious situation, and really an amazingly heroic moment. And it obviously saved the rest of the school, because if the fire had gone here, there were still, there were buildings going in the other direction too. So it was a huge, step that he was able to take to make that happen.
It's the stuff of legend, but he didn't talk about it, and he probably didn't think it was a big deal. He was a do what needed to be done kind of person. And in fact, that's the way he did so many things here, because when a need was unfilled, he would fill it. As you come up the driveway, it's Emmett to the left and Pittman to the right, and he was always her right-hand man.
One thing I remember is some of the boys were really wanting to go into the flames and save some of the Christmas books, and they weren't allowed to. And it was, I remember their distress, that was one of the things.
They were in tears.
Yeah, right? they were in tears.
Yeah.
And another thing is, I think that, was it Bennett Fry or someone went in and got Mrs. Emmett's gold, her coins?
Coins from around the world, like ancient Greek coins.
Very, very, yeah, like Alexander the Great on a gold coin that we used to look at. So that was the only thing that was saved during the fire.
So the day after the fire, when some students were allowed to go look in the ashes and see if there was anything left of Mrs. Emmett's precious artifacts and the things that were in the chapel and everywhere, one of the students
Bob Stevens, came to Mrs. Emmett like this and said, "I found the lamb." This is from the chapel. The lamb always sat in the chapel right next to the place where the person, where Mrs. Emmett would speak for the chapel, right on, with the candles and everything on the little table stand. And so from the ashes, we got the one thing that would come to chapel with us and end up in the new chapel.
I think when Mrs. Emmett discovered this place, she must have felt that there was a force, you know, in the earth here that was going to be able to be, I don't know if harnessed is the right word, channeled maybe, you know, for the benefit of whoever was involved here. And so whenever I come back here, you know, I'm just kind of coming up the hill and it's like this thing that happens. It's very cosmic.